Praise the Lord.
Kama yebazwe.
We are glad that we can come to you this morning.
Tuli basanyufu nti okujja gye muli amakyaga olwaleero.
Let us pray as we get into God's word.
Katusabe nga tuyingira mu kigambo kya Mukama.
Father, we thank you so much.
Mukama tukwebaza nnyo nnyini.
That we are preparing this message.
Yateekateeka obubaka buno.
Not in the morning.
Si ku makya.
But we know that many will hear it.
Netumanyi nti bangi bajja bawulira.
At about that time.
Mu kiseera ekyo.
So Lord, we commit everything we are going to share here.
Mukama tussa buli mikono gyo buli kyonna gye tugenda okukola wano.
And we pray, let your spirit move through the cameras, move through the media, and touch people's lives.
Leka moyo mutukuvu Mukama atambule mu kamera, atambule media, akome ku bantu bo.
And let your people be ministered to.
Era leka abantu bawerezebwe.
Prepare us for what is yet ahead.
Tuteketeke Mukama Katonda kureke kiri maso.
In Jesus name we pray.
Muri nyali ya Yesu tusabye.
Amen.
Amina.
Amen. So thank you for joining us.
Mwebale kutwega tako.
My name is Samuel Gonahasa.
Age manya gombolize.
And my brother
Nangi Deo Mboga.
Yeah, we are bringing the word of God to you today.
Tureke kigambo kya Mukama Katonda gye muli.
And as I have been, you know, meditating in my heart and asking God what he wants to say to us, I felt God emphasizing on two things. And I pray that he will be able to enable us to connect them. The first is understanding the times. I know we've had many messages come through to us about the period of time in which we are living. But it doesn't hurt to emphasize what we feel God is saying. And then the second thing that I felt God wanting to emphasize to us is that we should receive a baptism of love this Pentecost season. So to make it clearer, when we talk about understanding the times, the scripture that has been on my heart is the scripture in 1 Chronicles 12. Chapter 12, verse 32. It's a scripture which many people have maybe heard or read somewhere before. It says the men of
Issachar
who understood the times and knew what Israel should do. 200 chiefs with all their relatives under their command. So it says there were these men of the tribe of
Issachar.
And they had a certain understanding of what was going on, of the times or the seasons. And because they had that understanding, it is like God gave them a leadership ability. And that leadership ability caused their brethren to follow them. Because they were able to understand the times. And I think this applies in life in general. The people who are able to tell what is happening in the current circumstances, and who can also project potentially what the future has.
N'abasobola ate okulaba eyo maaso ebiseera by'emaaso kye birina.
Many times people look to them for guidance.
Abantu ebiseera bisinga batunuulira eri
they look to them for direction.
Babatunuulira eri okukulemberwa.
And that is how leaders come about.
Awo abakulembezi batwe bajja.
Because they help us to paint a vision.
Kubanga batuyamba okusiiga okwolesebwa.
Or to paint a picture of what the current things are and what the future is likely to look like.
Kifananyi embeere ya bulijjo nga bweri oba enajja mu maaso bweneeba.
So it was like God was saying to me that if you can get an understanding of the times, if you can realize what I am doing in the spirit, then you can become a leader. You can receive a leadership anointing. And you will be able to lead people into the destiny that I have. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So, we need to understand the times. We need to realize what is God doing. Last time we talked about how God is shaking the nations and how he's preparing his church for his soon return. I just wanted to point out some things about the times. As I've been listening to other people who share prophetic messages, they pointed out some interesting things. They said that, you know, this Passover, the one we've been in, and I talked about the Passover a few weeks ago. But the Passover that we are in during that Easter period is a very unique Passover. Because it is the one Passover which the whole world celebrated while under lockdown. Because it was exactly like the Passover when the people of Egypt the people of Israel were leaving Egypt. In that Passover, people were locked in their houses. And then there was a plague which was going on outside of their homes. And it was destroying people. And then they were preserved by the blood, the people of Israel, that is. And this is really a picture of what we are talking about here the other day. It's like the picture we're talking about the other day, when we said because of the covenant, we will be preserved. Those who are in covenant with God will be protected. But I'm coming back to the times. So you see that this last Passover that we went through, it looks like a real replica of the Passover that happened when the people of Israel were coming out of Egypt. A plague is outside. People are in their homes. They are locked down. They are afraid of the plague. And some are preserved. Exact same picture. Now the interesting thing is this. The Passover when Jesus died wasn't celebrated in necessarily the same way. But it ushered in, you know, a new time or a new season. The time when the church was born. Because really that's when the church was born. When Jesus died and rose again, then the church was born. Because we could now put our faith in Jesus Christ and we could be saved. Right after that Passover, 50 days went by. And when those 50 days went by, the day called the day of Pentecost came. And the reason they call it Pentecost, because Pente
kubanga ekigambo ekyo pente
means 50
kitegeeza ataano.
So it's just counting 50 days
kitegeeza okubala ennaku ataano.
So from the Passover
okuva kwitako
50 days
naku ataano,
and then Pentecost comes
ao Pentecost neja.
Just to clarify
okulungamyamu
40 of those days
nakwana kwezo
Jesus was on the earth walking with the people.
Yesu yali kunsinga atambula nabantu,
and then he left
nagenda,
and then after another 10 days
enaku 10 ngaziiseo
the Holy Spirit came on the church.
Mwe mtu kuvunaja ku kanisa.
So there was a baptism of the church
waliwo kubatiza okwe kanisa
with the Holy Spirit
no mwe mtu kuvun
beginning a new season
ngatutandika ebire bipya
for the church
ere kanisa.
And when the Holy Spirit came upon the church, power came upon us for the work of evangelism, for the work of healing the sick, for the work of raising the dead, for the work of the gospel to go out across the ends of the earth. Now it looks like it's almost 2,000 years since that time. And we are experiencing a unique Passover, but we are also standing at a place where we may be going to experience a unique Pentecost. A unique Pentecost. Praise the Lord. Now, if you look from Easter time, Pentecost is about 30th of May. So you may be hearing this message when it is already one day past. But it is never too late for God. Because what am I trying to say? I sense that God is trying to bring a message to us that we are entering another season. Another season of the baptism of the Holy Spirit and of power. But this power is coming upon the church for another phase of the church. For another phase of church operations. And I think this is the message that we were receiving last week. Becoming pioneers of change. The church becoming a pioneer of or breaking out of the four walls and beginning to touch the world in a way that deals with the real problems of the world. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So if you are following now, you'll understand that it seems there is an impending outpouring of the Holy Spirit in a new way, which is supposed to equip the church to do a certain thing which God has in his heart, which is going beyond just sharing the message of salvation, but actually is causing us to step out of the four walls of the church and beginning to interact with the world in a remarkable way to change it.
Tutandiko tabagana nensi mu ngere yo mugundu eyo kujichusa.
Praise the Lord.
Mukama yebazwe.
Praise the Lord.
Mukama yebazwe.
So this is the first part of what I needed to share.
Kino kye kitundu ekisoka kubaka bwenyaga dogabana.
Understanding the times.
Okutegeera ebiro.
Understanding the times.
Okutegeera ebiro.
Because when we understand the times,
kubanga batutegeera ebiro,
then we begin to position ourselves appropriately.
Awo tutandika okwesimba bulungi,
and we become leaders in the things that God wants to accomplish. Praise the Lord. Now, in the time of my study, I came across a verse which seemed to summarize for me. It was like God wanted to help me to summarize the message that he had put in my heart. Let us go to 1 Corinthians 16
and
verse 13. First Corinthians 16.
Bakorinse chisoka 16
verse 13.
Norunyiriri ore 13.
It says,
Chigamba bwechiti,
be on your guard.
Mwekume,
stand firm.
Muyimirire
in the faith.
Mukukiriza.
Be men of courage.
Mubere basajja abamanyi.
Be strong.
Mubere achwago.
And do everything in love.
Era mukole byonna mukwagalana.
When I read those words,
when nasomye ebigambo ebyo,
they seemed to summarize for me what I believe God wants us to grasp.
Nebibanga ebiwumba wumba ekyo mukama kyeyagadde nze nfune
in this message.
Obubaka buno.
As the times are changing,
ebiseera bimaze
okukyuka, as God is speaking to us and saying, I want you to begin to step out and to become pioneers of change.
Mukama ng'agamba nti njagala muveeyo mubeere abagunjawo enkyukakyuka.
He is reminding us the times in which we are living. They couldn't be more evil than now. This is so true. Because the Bible already says it in 2 Timothy. That in the last days, you know, there will be a lot of evil. And it points out so many things that will happen. So that's why God must remind us, be on your guard.
Mukama kyava tujukiza nti mwekumenga.
Stand firm in the faith.
Munywererenga mukukiriza.
This also ties in with our theme for the year.
Era kino kikwatagana n'omutwe gwaffe ogw'omwaka.
Which talks about strengthening your stakes.
Ekigamba tonyweze enkondozo.
Because the times that are here and that are coming will be times of more shaking.
Kubanga ebiseera ebiriwo n'ebiseera ebigenda okujja biseera bya kunyenyezebwa.
So God is trying to say to us, you know that these times are like this.
Mukama agezako tugamba nti manya ebiseera bino bwe bituviri.
But be on your guard.
Naye wekume.
And stand firm in the faith.
Onywererenga mukukiriza.
And then as you do that,
era ng'okola ekyo,
be men of courage.
Beranga musajja wa kuwagala.
When Joshua was about to bring the people of Israel into the land of promise, God had to deal with Joshua's mind. He had to challenge him and encourage him at the same time. He said to him, you're going to bring these people into this land. This is something that Moses only dreamt of. It was in the dreams of Moses. He always, you know, it was also in the dreams of Abraham who had died. Of Isaac and Jacob. You remember when Jacob was dying in Egypt? He said, please, when you go back to that land, carry my bones with you. Because I know that day is going to come when you will go into the land of promise. He was saying all these things by faith. Now, we are standing at a point in time. When God is saying, I want to begin to usher you into the fulfillment of my promises for the end time church. You know, we've had so many promises about the church. The glory of the latter church shall be greater than that of the former. We've had God saying, once more I will shake the nations, and after I've done all of that, I'm giving you an inheritance that cannot be shaken. We've had God saying to us, this is the time, this is the season for you as the church. But while that is the case, we are also standing at a point where the days are so evil and wickedness will increase. So we need God to remind us to say, be men of courage. You're going to have to make some decisions which are not going to be easy. You're going to go and get to the Jordan. and you're going to have to put your foot in and see if it will open up based on the promise of God. But I can tell you the truth, the God who has promised, he will never fail. I said he will never fail. Praise the Lord. I said he will never fail. But he challenges Joshua. And he says, be strong and of good courage. Because you will have to divide this land for the people of Israel. And the moment they cross like this, they are faced with a big wall. Some of you are going to begin things and then suddenly it's going to look like there are walls in front of you. Now I am not a prophet of doom, but I'm trying to tell you that even in the land of promise, as we begin to pioneer change, as we begin to pioneer transformation, we are going to be faced with challenges. But God says to us, be of courage. Be courageous. Because I will lead you. If you go back to Joshua chapter 1 and read those portions of scripture, God said to Joshua so many times, He said, fear not. And I want to say to you, fear not. Fear not at this time. Your previous business may have stopped. But fear not. I said fear not. Your contract at the office may be winding down or has even wound down. Fear not. Be of courage. Be of courage. God is bringing us into a new era. God is bringing us into a new period. A new season. And the anointing of God is going to carry us. I mean, think about the disciples. Jesus had just been with them. And after he died, it seemed hopeless. Then suddenly they got some hope when they saw him. So now they were thinking, okay, now the lockdown is over. I'm just relating it to the current circumstances. Okay, the lockdown is over. Jesus has risen. And of course they were thinking in Acts chapter 1. They were thinking, aha, now the time has come for him to restore the kingdom of Israel. So in fact they asked him. They said to him, Jesus, is it at this time that you will restore the kingdom? Is this the time that now you are going to sit on the throne and you become the king here in Israel? And he said to them, that is not for you. Don't disturb yourself about certain times and things which are in the control of God. But he made them a promise. He said, but you will receive power. You will receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. I want to say to you, you will receive power after that the Holy Spirit comes upon you. As God moves among us in this Pentecost season, you're going to receive power. I pray that the power of God will be released to you in the name of Jesus, so that you will receive power. May the power of God rest upon you. May the power of God rest upon you in the name of Jesus. For this new dispensation, for this new season, for this new time, so that you will have courage. So that you will have courage. The beauty is that God has made his promise. And God will never fail. God is not a man that he should lie. He's not a son of man that he should change his mind. Has he spoken to you about some big visions? Has he said to you, start a new business? Let me tell you, if you've heard it from God, just begin to walk. Of course, go and fall on your face humbleness before God and draw power from above and draw power from on high. Because God is saying to you, and probably he has sent us to announce it to you, that now he's releasing fresh power upon you. So go and fall on your knees and on your face before God and ask him for fresh power and ask him for the anointing. The anointing breaks the yoke. It deals with everything that hinders. It releases us into God's purposes. It anoints us to fulfill God's purpose. And this is the time. This is the season where God is saying, be courageous. What does it mean to be courageous? It means doing some things you've not done before. Some people are going to start their businesses online because that is where the market is. And they are wondering, but I don't have the skills. I don't know how to do this. You will receive power. You will receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And then you will be my witnesses. Then we can witness the mighty working power of God. We can witness it working in our businesses. We can witness it working in our families. We can witness it working in books that we are writing. Let me tell you, it's time for a new thing. You know, at the beginning of the year, I was requested to share at my son's school. My son's school is a Christian-based school. So the parents usually come together for a fellowship when the term is starting. And so the principal reached out and said, I would like to ask you to share. And he told me the theme is Isaiah 43, 18. See, I am doing a new thing. Behold, it springs forth. Now, when they gave me that scripture, quite frankly,
Dala,
this is early in the year. It is January. There is nothing significantly new that is happening. It was not the COVID days that we are living in now. I mean, we call them the COVID days now. But so, for some reason, we had been at Prayer Mountain with some friends the night before that sharing. And so, when we came back, it was an overnight. So, when we came back, they had asked me to be there at 11. So, I was really exhausted. So, I said, maybe let me lay down a bit. But then I realized the time was getting close. And I just needed to go and share. Anyway, long story short, I pushed my body because I was really tired. And went out there to share. And I said to some, I remember some of these words now. In the last week, I've been thinking about these words that God gave to us. It's like God sees things from a totally different plane. This is what I told the parents. And I said to them, when God says I am, and he announces, says I'm doing a new thing, you may not see it there and then. But actually he's doing a new thing. And you need to believe him. So like, okay. What does that really mean practically? And then the Lord quickened me to say to them, the primary responsibility of parents is actually to raise their children in the fear of God. We've many times handed them over to teachers and said, let the teachers teach them while we go to work. But I reminded them of what God said. spoke to Abraham.
Nembajukiza mukacha yogera
Ibrahim in Genesis 18.
Murubere bya
18. When he said to him, Abraham will teach
his
children after him
to
follow in my ways. And I said to them, God wants us to be the ones to take responsibility to teach our children. Praise the Lord. And then I did not know that the day is going to come when indeed the parents are the ones going to be seated with their children at home. Teaching. And you have to teach them, you know, things regarding what they have to learn at school. But you also have to be teaching them the ways of God. Praise the Lord. So when we were saying these things in January, we did not realize indeed God was doing a new That's why I'm saying we need to be mindful. Spiritually mindful. When we hear God announcing and saying a new season is coming into place, and there is a new and fresh anointing coming upon the church over this Pentecost season, which is ushering us into what he wants to do next. I tell you, friends, listen. Listen. Because the physical, it only follows the supernatural. 2 Corinthians 4:18 makes it clear. It says the things that are temporary. But the things that are unseen, they are eternal. Praise the Lord. So be men of courage. Step out. In faith. Go and seek God. Hear from him. And then step out in faith. Do something you've not done before. Praise the Lord. And God is anointing you. He's releasing this anointing upon you. Praise the Lord. Now, the last part of that portion of scripture. 1 Corinthians 16:14. It says, do everything in love. Do everything in love. While you're on your guard, while you're standing firm, while you're being men of courage and being strong, do everything in love. Whatever you do, do it in love. Now someone will say, but what is love again? why does God keep reminding us of love? Let me explain why this is so important. Some people, you go to them and you say, who is God? And they will say, obviously, you mean you don't know. God is God. And I will say, no. I will say no. Who is God?
Mukama yani.
Who is God?
Mukama yani.
God
Mukama
is
ye
love.
Kwagala.
God
Mukama
is
ye
love.
Kwagala.
Now he has names.
Aina manya.
But what is his substance?
Na ye echinus chichirwa.
Love.
Kwagala.
God
Mukama
is
ye
love.
Kwagala.
That is who he is. That's everything of his nature. And the Bible says to us, those who live in love live in God. And God in them. So you say, okay, no problem. You see, that is the only secret to walking continually in the power and the anointing of God. It is love. That is the only way you can continue. Because when you're walking in love, you're walking in the spirit. Some people think walking in the spirit is some mystic experience. No, I'm feeling the anointing. I'm feeling the anointing. Some mystic experience. Walking in love is walking in God.
It
is walking in the Spirit. You can never be out of the Spirit if you're walking in love. How? Because God is love. And he who lives in love lives in God. And God lives in him. And what is love? You see, when I want to understand the character of love, I think about how God deals with people. Because that is the character of love. The Bible says in Jeremiah 31, I think it's 31 and somewhere between 31 and 33, he says, "Behold, I have loved you with an everlasting love. And so with cords of kindness have I drawn you." If you go to Psalm 103, it says he crowns our lives with loving kindness and tender mercies. Loving kindness and tender mercies. How does your heart respond to God and to other people? Does it respond with loving kindness? Does it respond with mercy? Does it look at other people I'm trying to find the right description. The Bible says love prefers the other person. It says that, 1 Corinthians 13, maybe let's go there. Maybe we will. It says, verse 4, love is patient. When you find that your brother hasn't done what you expected him to do, do you respond with judgment? Or do you respond with patience? The character of love is to respond with patience. Praise the Lord. Love is patient. Love is kind. How do you respond to others? Are you kind? Is your heart moved with compassion? It talks about Jesus when he walked on the earth. He says he looked at them and they looked like sheep without a shepherd. And he was moved with compassion. Some people think this kindness and compassionateness is supposed to be left to the pastors and the preachers. They are the ones whom we should expect kindness from. But not from me, the normal everyday believer. In fact, what is funny is that sometimes the believers, ordinary, are expecting loving kindness and tender mercies from the pastor. Instead of expressing kindness and tender mercies to the pastor. Praise the Lord. I'm giving us some things to think about. Sometimes we are the ones expecting people to be kind to us. Or to be patient with us. But not trying to be patient towards us. Let us go to the book of Philippians chapter 2. A scripture which I've been meditating on in the last few days a lot. But I think it brings out the picture of love the way it should be. It says in we can read from verse 1. No, let's go to verse 3 in the interest of time.
But Philippi bili satu.
Yes, Philippians 2:3. It says, do nothing out of selfish ambition.
Temukulanga chindu chonna oroku yomba.
Or vain conceit.
Ne wakubade orechitiwa.
But in humility, consider others better than yourselves.
Wabula mbuombe fubuli muntu agulumizenga munne okusinga bwe yegulumiza yekka.
Each of you should look not only on to your own interests,
temutunuliranga buli muntu bibye yekka,
but also to the interests of others. Era naye
buli muntu n'ebyabalala.
Many times,
bisera bingi,
we consider ourselves before we consider others.
Twefaako nga tetunaba kufa ku balala.
That's why when you're driving in town, even just after the lockdown these last few days,
yes,
people are pushing and shoving, trying to enter in ahead of another person. It's an attitude of thinking about myself more than the other person.
But
if I was considering the other person more than I consider myself, I would give them way and they go first. Praise the Lord. Considering others before yourself. Then the other thing is this. Look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. A few days ago, I got a call from someone. And the person was saying, okay, the lockdown has lifted.
Or
is lifting. And I want to start a small business. But I need some capital to start. So we talked about that. And I said, well, I don't really have, you know, all the money. But let me go and think through and see how it is possible. Then after that, the person said, but even now, is it possible for you to send me something? Now the interesting thing is I only had 17,000 shillings. That may surprise some people. Because when you dress up nicely and you drive probably a good car, people think you always have money. I only had 17,000. So I say to him, I only have 17,000. Right.
Yeah,
but maybe let me send you 10. I guess God will find a way to sort me out. So I sent him what I had. And God is faithful. He sorted me out. He found a way to make sure I am covered. I'm giving that example not because I have too much, but to say I need more of God's working in my life. To continue demonstrating those kind of things. Living that kind of life. Preferring others before yours. And this is what God is calling us to. Some people have a sense of entitlement. Like I said before, those people who have some money should give us who don't have. God is saying, don't put your interest before the other person. It goes both ways. Because what you may be thinking the other one has, he may even not have. And then you judge them. Because you think you know what is there in their life. The Bible says, prefer others before yourself. Extend kindness of heart. If someone maybe has not, there are times when I've had, you know, someone calls maybe and then you are busy, you're entangled in some things. And then you may even forget to call back. Now, the other person may say, this person doesn't care about us. But think about the times when you yourself, that, I'm now talking about that other person, when you that you yourself have also missed a call, but maybe you forgot to call back. What do you think the other person was thinking? If he also thought of you as a person who doesn't care, is that love? Think more highly of others than of yourself. Have tenderness of heart. I have loved you with an everlasting love. And so with cords of kindness I have drawn you. And these are matters of the heart. Some of the examples I'm giving may not apply to some people. But the issue is, how is your heart disposed towards a person? How does your heart respond to another person? When they mention that name, what comes to your mind? Is it kindness?
Chisa?
Is it goodness?
Bulonji?
Is it thinking of all the good things that that person is and does? Or do you think of all, you remember the other bad one and then the other bad one? Praise the Lord. The state of heart. Why am I saying all this? In the book of Acts, when the Holy Spirit was poured out, the church became so full of love. This is what happened. There was a baptism of love. There was a baptism of love. What do I mean by baptism of love? It's really a baptism of God. That is what it means, the baptism in the Holy Spirit. He said Jesus will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. But the Holy Spirit, when he comes, he brings the very nature of God. He brings love. Love where people were willing to sell what they had and bring the money and say, let's help the ones who are in need. Praise the Lord. Love where they were willing to, you know, they said, the Bible said at that point actually there was no lack in the church. It reached that point where there was no lack in the church. Because people were so full of love. Their hearts were full of love. Praise the Lord. This is one of those key things that God is calling us to do. You're going to forfeit some things to do the ones that God is saying to do. And in order to do that, you're going to have to love. For God so loved that he gave. You're going to have to love so much that you are willing to forfeit what you would have had to bless others or to fulfill the goodness of God to the life of another person. Praise the Lord. So this is for us to search our hearts as we enter into this new season. I pray that God will fill us with love, where we look not only on our own interests but also to the interests of others. Hallelujah.
Amina.
Hallelujah.
Amina.
Praise the Lord. I want us to end here. But I'm looking for that scripture in Romans 15, verse 13. And this is my prayer, which was also the prayer of Paul the Apostle. He said, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. so that you may overflow with hope. By the power of the Holy Spirit. May He fill you with joy and peace as you put your trust in Him. Because our trust is not going to be in what we have known in the past.
It's
not going to be in our bank accounts. It's not going to be in the previous experiences you knew. It is going to be in the Holy Spirit of God who is poured out upon us. But as you respond in love and do what God is saying to
you,
I can tell you something. God will fill you with joy and peace. And you will abound in hope because of the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
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 Understand the times and receive a baptism of love. These are the things I believe the Lord is saying. Let us pray as we come to a close. Father, we thank you for the way you teach and instruct us in the word. Thank you for the times and seasons in which we live. Thank you that things are shifting in the spirit. And you're saying to us, I want to do a new thing. And I want you to be pioneers of change. Lord, we humble ourselves under your word. And we pray, fill us with power. Fill us with power. In this new Pentecost season, fill us with power from on high. Fill us with power that makes us courageous. Like the disciples, when they were filled with power from on high, they spoke the word of God boldly. Lord, may we get money and do investments boldly. May we stand up and take this inheritance and show it to the people that you have prepared it for. In the name of Jesus, show us how to be courageous. Show us how to be strong. To be decisive. To stand up and be counted. In the day of your power. In the name of Jesus. And Lord, fill our heart with love. So that even though outwardly we seem so bold and courageous, our hearts will be so tender and so soft towards one another. That we may love one another deeply. Because this was what you asked us to do. You said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. If you love one another. Father, thank you for your word. Receive all the glory. Be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving.
Amen.
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 Amen.